This morning, as we are entering into this summer season, I would like to do a series for the months of July and August on developing our faith and how we can actually grow in our faith. So we're going to be looking at a number of different challenges that God is going to put into the life of each one of us. And I know that people talk about we need to live by faith. And the writer of Hebrews says, now the faith is the substance of things hoped for, the evidence of things that is not actually seen. So we have to take some steps and to see what God is going to do. So here's the big question that we want to look at. Do I actually trust God? I think it boils down to that. Do I actually trust God in this journey of life that we are engaged in as a number of people? Some of you are well aware of the movies that have been portrayed in Hollywood that deal with all kinds of issues. One of the movies that I've always liked, and the series, just because they're so wild and crazy and action-oriented, are the series done by Indiana Jones. Any of you watch Indiana Jones? Oh, good. I'm not alone here. So there is one movie where his father is an archaeologist. Now, I thought being an archaeologist would be pretty unexciting until I saw Indiana Jones. So he wasn't stuck in a dusty library reading ancient tombs. He was out on the field gathering evidence. And it was so exciting, I thought, I think I'd like to become an archaeologist. Except it's not real life. But his father, played by Sean Connery, was an archaeologist, kind of the typical absent-minded professor who was doing his own thing. And in the one movie called The Last Crusade, there is a book that they are following. Of course, there's always the bad guys chasing them. And they're searching for the cup of eternal life. Well, in this journey, his father gets wounded, and he is dying. And Indiana Jones has to find a way to save his father. And so what you're going to see in a moment is a video clip which talks about taking a step of faith. We're going to watch this. So that's what you might call a leap of faith. And so this morning, one of the things that we want to do as we begin this series is to understand that if we're going to be following Jesus, that we really have to live by faith. That's what God calls us to do. And sometimes God is going to call us to take a huge step of faith. He's going to move us out of our comfort zone. And sometimes we can't actually figure out what is going on or what God is actually doing, but he's going to be saying to us, will you trust me one step at a time? And what happens is this, is that when we step out in faith, God reveals his presence and his power in our lives. But for a lot of people, they would rather stand perfectly still. And very often, they are paralyzed by fear. And so in their fear, they don't take a step forward. They simply say, this is what I know, this is my comfort zone, and this is where I am going to stay. And so when that happens, they refuse to take that first step of faith as God is prompting them to move forward. And if you don't take that step of faith, then you do not see God's involvement and God at work in your life. So as we begin this morning, the question I'd like you to think about is this. Are there areas in your personal life where you are resisting the leading of God? Is God prompting you? Is God nudging you? Is he encouraging you to take a step forward? And you are somewhat resistant and hesitant in what you are doing. And so I would invite you, as we go through this series, to let God speak into your life and to discover the ways in which he wants to enable you to grow in your faith. So this morning, as we begin this series, I'm going to have to depend on the staff to move this forward. We're going to be looking at a new generation that actually was going to take a step of faith. In the readings that we heard this morning, the nation of Israel had been in captivity for 400 years. They had been led by Moses out of captivity on the journey towards the promised land. It had taken a period of 40 years from the time they left Egypt until they faced the promised land. Several generations had gone by. A generation is approximately 20 years. And so there were some people who entered the promised land that had never been in captivity in Egypt. And what we find is that the people who had left Egypt, who were 20 years of age and over, they all died in the desert. They never made their way into the promised land. And the reason was, they refused to trust in God. And they were just part of that group of people who wandered around for 40 years in the desert. Now we have a new generation, and they are facing a new challenge. This new generation is at the edge of the Jordan River. And God says, I want you to cross over. They had had that experience of living for a long period of time in the desert. And God says, I don't want you remaining here. I want you to go into the new land that I have promised to give to you. So the question is, would this new generation have faith to do what God was asking them to do? Or would they follow the ways of their parents who were paralyzed in trusting God and did not move forward? So Joshua now is the new leader of Israel. And he knew what God wanted. So there was a challenge that they were going to face. And the challenge is this. He says, I want you to arise and cross the Jordan River. You and all the people to the land which I am actually giving to them. Now, if you were the leader, if you were Joshua, I am sure you must have had some misgivings. Will these people go with me? He had seen their obstinate character for the years prior when Moses was their leader. And now he is facing this new challenge to take these people across the Jordan River to the promised land. But there is a promise that God had given to them. And the promise is found in these words. No one will be able to stand before you all the days of your life. As I was with Moses, I will be with you. Now listen to these words. I will not fail you, and I will not forsake you. That's an incredible promise. No one will be able to stand against you all the days of your life. Think back, Joshua. You remember how I was with Moses? Think of all the difficulties he experienced. As I was with Moses, so I will be with you, and I won't fail you, and I won't abandon you. Joshua, I will be there for you. Well, he didn't have all the specifics of what God wanted him to do, but he acted upon the information that he had received, because he had heard it directly from God. And the reason he was willing to act upon it is because he believed that God is faithful to the promises that he actually makes. Do you believe God is faithful to the promises he makes? There are hundreds and hundreds of promises recorded in Scripture. Is God faithful to us as he was to Moses? And as you will see, as he was to Joshua, God says, I am the Lord, I do not change. I am the same yesterday, today, forever. And Joshua acted on the promises. But he had some instructions, and the instructions are these. Be strong and courageous. That's the first thing. You got to be courageous. You got to bolster up your strength. Don't wimp out. Be strong, be courageous. Be careful to do everything according to the law which my servant Moses commanded you to do. In other words, God is saying, follow my directions. Don't turn to the left, to the right, so that you may have success in everything you do. God says, if you follow me, you don't deviate one way or the other, you will have success in what you are doing in your life. Now he knew that God had done this before. Joshua was there when they fled from Egypt and they came to the Red Sea. And you remember the sea is in front of them and the Egyptian army is behind them. And they're wondering, what are we going to do? And God provided a way across that body of water. And he saw how God was faithful to Moses in giving leadership to the people. So God's power was going to be with him as it was with his predecessor, Moses. So there was a challenge, there was a promise, and he had very clear instructions. This is what you are to do. You are to do everything according to what is written in my word. Don't deviate to the left or the right. And if you do follow me with your whole heart, you will have success in what is taking place in life. But now he faces the challenge. And the challenge is this, getting your feet wet. You've got to get your feet wet. And to do that, you have to take a step of faith. What is God asking him to do? Well, the instructions are very clear. We read it in chapter 3. And in chapter 3, we read these instructions. Step in the water. When you see the Ark of the Covenant of the Lord your God, with the Levitical priest carrying it, you shall set out from your place and go after it. When you come to the edge of the waters of the Jordan, you shall stand still in the Jordan. We're thinking, really? Is this is what we are to do? We are to step in the water? So what they were to do was that the priests were to carry the Ark of the Covenant. Now the Ark of the Covenant is a box. It was 4 feet long by 2.5 feet by 2.5 feet. And it carried symbols of God's redeeming power and grace. It was carried by poles, and the priests would carry it. And the priests were to come to the edge of the water. So by carrying this ark, it was a symbol for all the people to see that the presence of God was actually with them. But there's something rather interesting. They were carrying this ark across the water during flood season. I don't know if you saw what happened in West Virginia last week in the news with a torrential rain where they got 9 inches. They got the equivalent in one day what they normally get in about 3 to 4 months. And there were floodwaters everywhere. Sometimes you can see the spring runoff, and you know how rivers become very, very powerful. Even the waters around Paris, you will see the water flowing rapidly, and it can be very dangerous. Now, normally, it's not very difficult to cross the Jordan River. If any of you have ever been to the Holy Land, and you have seen the Jordan, in some places, it's not a very big body of water. Sometimes the water is only 3 feet deep. Sometimes it reaches to about 6 feet. And you can easily go to places where you could cross the river and hardly get wet. So it would be a piece of cake to do that. You just find a place where the water is shallow and you will cross over. But this is during flood season. It's during the season of harvest. And the waters now fill the entire riverbed. Instead of it just being a few feet across in some places, it's about 150 feet across because the water has spread out over the banks. And the water now is between 10 and 20 feet deep. Now, I don't know how far 20 feet is, but I'm willing to guess it's higher than the railing around the balcony. I don't really venture the idea of trying to walk through a body of water like that, and how deep that would actually be. And so this is what God is asking them to do. I want you to cross this body of water onto the far side. But here's what's going to have to happen. God says to the priests, you have to come to the edge of the water, put your foot down, and then the water will part. And the water will be, you will have access to actually get across the river. It's not the other way around. Some people say, God, can you kind of part the waters, then I'll walk across? God says, no. The act of faith is this. You take the first step, and then I will part the waters. So here is a principle that we need to understand. And the principle is this. Sometimes God waits to act until we begin to move in faith. We need to underscore that. Sometimes God waits to act until we begin to move in faith. God wants to know, do you trust me? Have you heard me speak into your life? Do you know my promises? Are you willing to act on what I have said? Very often, when we face obstacles, and we can't overcome them, we say to God, God, can you make a way for this to open up? Can you somehow deliver me from this situation? But God is saying to us this morning in this story, you've got to trust. You have got to take the first step of faith. And when we walk in faith, we begin to see God's power displayed in absolutely amazing ways. So the people listen and they obey. And look what happens. We read in Joshua 3 these words. When those who were carrying the ark came into the Jordan, the waters which were flowing down from above stood and rose up in one heap. And the priests who were carrying the ark stood in the middle of the Jordan, while all of Israel crossed on dry ground. So the priests are carrying the ark. They come to the edge of the Jordan. They take that first step. The waters start to recede. The priests now walk into the middle of the river. And they remain there till the entire nation of Israel crosses over, and the people are now on dry land. And when they are there, Joshua said to the people, I want you to take 12 stones from the middle of the river. And each stone represents one of the 12 tribes of Israel. And they would take those stones, and they went to the place where they were going to camp that night, and they built a memorial so they could always remember the faithfulness of God in crossing the Jordan River, and how as they acted by faith, God fulfilled his promises. And so generations to come could see the faithfulness of God to his word. They would tell the story of how people were willing to take that first step and God acted. They could see the deliverance of the Lord. But all of us are going to face challenges in life. So how will we face the challenges that God is giving to us? What is God asking of you? What is he asking of me to take a step of faith today? You must choose, like that first generation, will I die in the wilderness, or will I take that step of faith, see the waters part, and enter into God's adventure? So what do you want to do? Die in the wilderness? Or do you want to step into a new adventure? God says, I've gone ahead of you. God says, I'll be there with you. But you must choose. You must believe enough to take the first step of faith. To believe is, do I trust that God's promises are true and that God will not disappoint me? So how do you know what your Jordan is? What is the river that you need to cross? I have found that the best thing to understand what our personal Jordan River is to ask this question, what do I fear the most? What are your fears telling you? God honors faith, and we need to not only take it seriously, but to act upon it. It is not a leap into the dark. Some people think faith is just a leap into the dark. No, faith is taking a step, trusting in the promises of God that are sure and certain. And very often, we don't want to do that. A number of years ago, I decided for the first time to go ziplining. Any of you ever gone ziplining? It's an awesome experience, except my heart was racing the first time I did it. So we get to this place, we're down somewhere in Mexico or Costa Rica or somewhere, and they said you could do this canopy zip lining, and you're going to go through over the jungle, and you go from one zip line station to the next. So we get there, and we have to go up this long series of stairs till we get to a tower, and there they put you in a harness, and they give you a helmet, and they give you some basic instructions like how to stop before you hit the tree at the other end. And so we're sitting there, and you get to the edge, and it's hundreds of feet down. And I'm thinking, will this harness hold me? So I've kind of looked around, and I saw a few people about my size, and some were even bigger. And they seemed to go across, and I thought, good for them. And you get to the edge, and you've got to take that step where you go into space. And at that point, your heart is kind of racing. I'm sure my blood pressure was somewhat elevated. And I thought, I've got to trust, and I've just got to do it. And as I stepped off, it was an awesome experience. The next time around, it wasn't so bad because I thought, I've already done this before. Isn't that true for us? Have you been able to trust God? Think about all your experiences of trusting God, and he's bringing some new adventure into your life, and he's saying, and will you trust me in this moment as well? I am faithful and sure, and my promises are for you. Well, we look at Joshua, and he had to take some challenges in his own life. At the very beginning of his leadership, he faced one of the greatest challenges. That is, how do I lead about 2 million people into the promised land? It's an overwhelming task. So what does God do? God gives him reassurance. And here is God's reassurance that we read of in Joshua 1. As I was with Moses, so I will be with you. That's amazing. God knows that Joshua has some fears. It's understandable. We've never been here before. We don't know what it's like. We don't know what we're going to experience. Moses knew that when he was dying, he was to hand over the leadership to Joshua. And he charged Joshua in front of all the nation. He said, Joshua, trust in God and follow his word completely. Don't veer to the left, don't veer to the right. As God has been with me, he will be with you. But trust him. God guaranteed his success in this incredible statement as we read in verse 7. God says to Moses, you must follow God completely. Be careful to do according to all the law which my servant Moses commanded you. Do not turn from it so that you may have success in all that you do. In other words, here's what God's saying. You must do what I tell you. Period. That's it. Don't deviate from it. Don't make it less than it is. Just do what I say. And you see, when we walk in obedience to what God says, we will experience the blessing of God. Well, we're starting this series on living by faith. And I want to suggest, and I want to challenge you, that it's time for spiritual risk-taking. It's time for each of us to say, God, I'm willing to step into the Jordan River. And God's power is often released when people are willing to trust him enough to simply obey what he says. But there will be some people who will spend their entire life sitting on the riverbank. They say, Lord, you part the water, then I'll step in. Some people say, God, could you kind of make it easy for me? Or could you just take away my fear? Or give me some kind of a guarantee. I like guarantees. God often waits to act until we step out in faith. So here's what some people say. You know, God, give me lots of money. Then I'll be generous. God says, I want you to commit to me biblically what I've instructed you with what you have right now. That's the first step of faith. I trust God and he will act. Or sometimes we say, God, give me the confidence to tell someone about you. Give me a spirit of boldness, then I'll do it. But until then, I'm saying nothing. You see, God is calling all of us to tell people about the good news. And the first step is when people speak, even when they are nervous. I just got back from 8 days of riding the motorcycle through the mountains, and I was with seven of my friends that we've done this every year. And one day, one of the guys decided he was just going to take the day off. And he stayed back, and as we got back, we said, so how was your day? And he said, I think I experienced an interesting God moment. He said there was a man who came through and was staying in the same resort that we are, and he was carrying some groceries. And we got chatting, and he started to tell me how this was a very difficult time for him. And he said it was this week, 6 years ago, that his son died. And he was grieving the loss of his son. It was some kind of a mix-up that happened, and he wasn't properly cared for. And he said, I wanted to say something to him. So he just said, well, let's talk about it. So the guy sat down, and my friend said to him, he said, I was feeling really nervous, but he said, I didn't want to give him just platitudes and say, these are nice words that I want to offer to you, but how could I minister to him? And he said, you know, sometimes when we go through these hard places, I find it's really helpful if I can pray. And he said, could I offer a prayer for you? And the guy said, that would be amazing if you would just pray for me. And he offered a prayer. And as he was praying, he said, the tears were streaming down his cheeks. And he said at the end of the prayer, you know, thank you. I needed that more than you can ever imagine. And he got up and walked away. You see, God's bringing us surprising encounters in ways that we can begin to reveal the amazing glory and grace of God if we'll take the step of faith. He could have said at the end, well, thanks for sharing your story, and you know, I hope things go well for you and other platitudes. But he said, how can I minister to him? So did you feel nervous? Oh, I felt really nervous. But I felt being prompted by God, and I took that step of faith. And he said, it was just amazing how our relationship developed. I never saw that man before. I'll probably never see him again. But it was a moment of grace that touched his life and touched his life. First step people. People who take the first step of faith are people who will even speak when they are nervous. So the challenge is we all need to commit to taking some risks. When we stepped into the edge of the river by obeying God, he uses us in amazing ways. So here's the question. Will we be the generation who says yes to God's adventure? You have to step into the Jordan. Nobody else can do it for you. But when you do, you'll be stepping into an adventure of life that's transformational. So here is the question as we reflect upon this message. Will we be a generation that trusts God and follows him? Will you risk getting your feet wet? Let's pray together.